The Dirty Dozen is the brass band equivalent of Duke Ellington.
Now get up, let me see you get up. It's all right if you have a good time. We give no refunds. Come on, get up.
My mom bought me a Dirty Dozen brass band album called Ears to the Wall. I don't even know if you can find it anymore, but it was their first funk album. Where they had electric on bass and keyboards and guitar, and it was different than anything else that they've ever done. And I fell in love with that album, and that album is what like truly turned me on to playing this kind of music. I've never heard anything like that in my life. From that moment on, they were my favorite band. I was like, look, can't nobody mess with this band, this is it.
They basically took a music form that was a whole lot of fun and made it into something even more sophisticated and more complicated, but yet every bit as fun. Before the Dirty Dozen came along, that tradition was really in danger of dying out.
This was in the early to mid 70s, and by that time most of the social and pleasure clubs had become dormant. Well, the main provider of music for those functions were brass bands. The evolution of phonograph records and electronic music also took away the necessity of having the brass bands.
Some of the older band was still around, but some of the older band had stopped doing them parades.
We started out with an expressed interest in wanting to learn traditional New Orleans jazz and wanting to learn traditional New Orleans music or jazz in general, but there weren't any gigs. And so we had gotten into a pattern of rehearsing in the evenings. We would rehearse, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 hours, 3 or 4 or 5 nights a week.
Practicing, mm-hmm. Practice. That's what we did. We practiced constantly. Kurt Joseph had a little outhouse in the back of his parents' house. We would practice all day and sometimes all night.
Kurt and I used to practice so much, I used to wind up sleeping by his house.
There weren't any gigs, so we started to bring other music to the rehearsal. Some Dizzy Gillespie, some Miles Davis, some Charlie Parker, some Aretha Franklin, some James Brown, some Marvin Gaye.
We played traditional New Orleans music, but we mixed in the other contemporary sounds of other artists and even our avant-garde. You know, we go out on a cloud, man. You go where man have never gone before. You know what I'm saying? Trying to play the music of Charlie Parker is not an easy task. You gotta sit down there, man, and shade on that stuff. You gotta spend hours and hours. I mean, a group of people gotta sit down there and take your time and dissect every note.
That's what practice would be like, trying to master this music, trying to get it right.
We just, you know, started to build from there with what we were doing musically, and that became, you know, the sound of the Dirty Dozen.
Bringing something that was totally different from the other older established bands at that time, which was Olympia and Tuxedo. We tried to be a traditional band, but they had it sold up, you know, they were already established, you know.
Now we did take some heat from some of the older guys who were telling, oh, you can't play that, that's not New Orleans jazz, that's not brass band.
We wanted to do, you know, a little something a little different. They didn't like it too much.
Older musicians were saying we wasn't going to make it because the music we were playing was a real up-tempo. They ain't going to make it because that music is too fast. People can't dance off that music.
New Orleans music is kind of, you know, that kind of thing, kind of laid back. We were, and people start bug jumping and doing all this fancy feet work.
Old dude said, yeah, that ain't New Orleans music. We say it's our music, you know?
You know, I look back at Olympia. I mean, they played things of their time. High heel sneakers. That wasn't traditional. I'm saying, you play Professor Longhair. That wasn't traditional.
We had a decision to make. Should we, on one hand, listen to the old guard who was telling us don't do that because they wanted us to play what they were playing, or play what this new set of people who were hiring us, who were paying us to come play the gig.
The audience loved it. You know, I mean, that's why we're doing what we're doing. Some of the musicians didn't like it, but we were working, and it wasn't working.
Play what they want to hear, or listen to the old guys, don't play this and get no gigs, or play this and get some gigs. We chose you know, to get the gigs.
But it's all over now. Come on, everybody, sing along. That's when I used to love her. But it's all over now.
When we first started playing the first gigs was at a Hardin Park playground, which wasn't far from our house in the 7th Ward, for like slow pitch baseball games.
We had an association with Benny Jones.
They used to play baseball on a Tuesday night in Hardin Park.
Benny was well known to a lot of the social pleasure clubs. And
so I said, look, man, we're going to take the band. We're going to come in Hardin Park while y'all playing. So after the game over, the band will strike up and go to Darrell's on Sonantan Street, about 3-4 blocks from the park.
We started parading from the games to the club, and then we started playing in the club, you know. So just how I was picking up. While people were catching on, crowds just got bigger and bigger. And before you know it, there were other club owners that were interested in doing the same thing. Everybody wanted some dozen. It was the, you know, it was the new thing on the street.
We had to play Moose to Booch, Bongo Beat, you know, all of these tunes, Oop Pop a Dop and all. But we had to have the street thing happening. So there's a certain kind of way that you mix that, you know? And we were lucky enough to hit it right on the head.
And the people that were hiring us, they wanted to hear this so-called new music. It wasn't that it was new, so to speak, because we were playing jazz from the 40s and 50s and, you know, R&B from the 60s and 70s or whatever, you know, adding those elements to what we were playing. It wasn't that it was new, it was just that it was being presented by a brass band.
We didn't figure it out, we wasn't even thinking about it. We just brought it to say, man, let's play Blue Monk. So we was going out, do-do-do-do, and people were like, people are open-minded, man. So they be going do-do-do-do, and people just going down the street, slow dragging down the street. Can you imagine a whole thousands of people just doing this? You know, then we might go into like Caravan. Boy, they're dancing and they're little feet going like that and they're doing all this kind of stuff, you understand?
The young people were loving the music because the time was changing. They wanted some different kind of music. So many people around the Dirty Dozen, you couldn't you hard to see the band.
We hit with Night Train, you know, and the whole crowd all of a sudden was surrounding us, you know, because they never heard, you know, Night Train other than the version that was done on a jukebox, you know?
So I used to always say, if you ever come to a second line and the Dirty Dozen is playing, make sure you bring your jogging suit and your tennis shoes, because you're going to roll, you know.
The Glass House was a small black ballroom that maybe could seat 30 people, 25 or 30 people. We used to play there on Monday nights.
Cost you a dollar to get in, and Thelma would give you a plate of red beans and rice. You had to buy a drink. That was like the proving ground for stuff, you know. They liked it and they danced to it. That's it.
So you had those dancers, those steppers, coming out, you know, to do their steps.
We were young. I was in my early 20s, and we would play music that would challenge these young dancers, buck jumpers that would come out to the show. And then they would always look forward to coming to the Glass House to practice their new dance moves and all that kind of stuff. So that was an interaction that I always cherish. I can still see, you know, that kind of thing happening.
You know, some of the best dancers that they had in New Orleans at that time was in the Glass House. It was Mardi Gras every Monday night.
It was so crowded you could hardly move in the place. They had a bunch of people inside and a bunch of people outside still trying to get in. So the
chairs in front of us to stop the dancers from just running over us too, you know?
If you put 25 people in there, you got packed. We must have put about 50 in there or more.
The air conditioning wasn't enough. Whether it was winter or not, or summer, it was hot, man.
There's a lot of people of status was coming to the club to experience it, you know?
People that would come to town to play, the big jazz gig, after hours they would come hang out, you know, at the Glass House, you know, with the Dirty Dozen.
Fats Domino liked to go to little neighborhood clubs. So I was telling Fats, I said, yeah, man, I'm gonna be playing at the Glass House. He said, oh, yeah, you'll play over there. I said, yeah. He said, okay, I'm gonna come over there and see you. So one night we playing, Fats Domino sitting at the bar, drinking his Heinekens, Dizzy Gillespie and Bernard Purdy. And in the back of the room, you got Manhattan Transfer.
It was Dizzy Gillespie. It was John Hendricks, you know, Lambert Hendricks and Ross. B.B. King used to come up.
You know, Charlie Williams, Widespread Panic, you know, Black Crowes.
At the time, I didn't know that the word was spreading or that it meant something, you know, to different people. We ended up recording and are doing, you know, live shows, you know, with all those people because they heard or recognized something in what we were doing that they wanted to be a part of what they were doing, which was, you know, quite an honor.
To what Diz even said, you know, boy, I'm glad to hear y'all doing something with the music. I was tired of hearing the same and playing the same stuff. And Diz loved what we was doing, you know.
We were doing probably about 240, 250 shows per year, consistently for about 25, 30 years. But we were doing more shows than anybody, you know, coming out of New Orleans.
They thought of themselves as a band fully capable of playing with any band in the world on a concert stage, on a performing arts stage, not just a festival stage. And they've proven that time and time again, not just with their own records, but with the collaborations they've engaged in over the years, the type of artists that have worked with them and used those guys, everyone from, you know, the Black Crowes to Widespread Panic to Elvis Costello, the list goes on and on. The fact that they were able to operate at that level and interact with those acts and make what those guys did better is testament to how good they are in and of themselves.
We had to play inside of the fountain, inside of Congress Square. They were opening up Armstrong Park, Louis Armstrong Park. We had got together on St. Philip Street side of the park, which that was where Tuba Fat had an apartment there at that time, but he wasn't there. Some kind of way we met up there. We walked across the park together, and it was like, they're coming. They're coming. They're here. All right. Ooh. But it was us, you know. And it was beautiful to be received. Yeah. You know, it was. And I could also remember a time, it was on the corner of Villery and Basin. We was doing the second line. It was a Social Pleasure Club. And wow, it was so many people. The ground was shaking. All right, wow. How could this be? This brings joy to me. That I've been blessed to be part of that. I have a lot of friends to the day. From all of that. That was special moments that I'll never forget. You know what I mean? That's just here.
We made a difference, you know, in the life of music and culture in New Orleans. This is my home. You know, I've had the pleasure of traveling all over the world. There's no other place in the world I would rather live and die than in New Orleans, Louisiana.
I think a lot of brass bands subsequent to the Dirty Dozen came into existence largely based on the inspiration of the Dirty Dozen Brass Band. I mean, they inspired a lot of these guys coming up and kind of gave them something to aspire to, just both musically and professionally. So they showed a lot of these younger bands what was possible.
That's all right. The table is turning. Now I turn the crowd.
I love those cats, man. And like they tell me, you know, once a dozen, always a dozen.
Sing along with Jimmy, he can say, that's when I used to love her, but it's all over now.
Dirty Dozen have music for your mind, body, and soul.
One thing I used to say, we play people music, you know, and as long as the people love it, we're gonna play it.